Please welcome Bob Gower. He is Agile coach and transformation consultant from United States. Welcome.
Good morning. So I'm very happy to be here, even though it's 3 a.m., I think, in my body right now. But I was really excited when EPAM invited me to be a part of this conference. I got to fly from New York. I've never been in Minsk before. I've never been in Eastern Europe before, so this is my first time. It's very exciting. And I really enjoy, what I enjoy about my job mostly is that I get to travel around and see really interesting, smart people that are way smarter than me, way cooler than me, doing really interesting things. So I'm very excited. I'm actually going to stay around, I think, for a few days and get a chance to see the area and also see what's going on here in Minsk. So I'm very excited, and please engage with me when you see me out there. I'd love to know what you're up to and if there's any way that I can help. So when I first planned to do this talk, I didn't have the talk. All I had was an idea. And the idea was to talk about the common mistakes software teams make, because in my work, what I do is I travel around and I see people do things, and I always see the same mistakes over and over again. And then after I finished writing the talk, I realized that this is not the title that I wanted to put on the talk, because if all we're trying to do is not make mistakes, that's a very, very low bar to put for ourselves, right? And I think in today's age, we want to put a very high bar for ourselves. What I really want to talk about today, okay, turn this on. What I want to talk about today is turning vicious cycles into virtuous cycles, the idea of systems thinking in great software. Now, I know this is a whole mouthful of words. Don't worry, I'm going to explain what I mean. I'm going to explain my terms. When I think about a vicious cycle, and a vicious cycle, vicious seems means essentially a mean or a bad cycle, I think of the problems we have actually in America, in a lot of big cities all around the world, of what we might call urban decay or urban blight. This is actually a picture of my hometown, which is Philadelphia. This is not where I grew up, but this is not far from where I grew up. And what we have is we have poor educational opportunities. We have unemployment. The unemployment leads to poverty, which leads to poor educational choices, which in turn leads to people not being very employable, which leads to poor unemployment, and so forth and so on. And so you have these sort of downward spiral. Things get worse and worse and worse. And in many of our software companies, many companies I walk into, I see the same problems, the same sort of idea, not the same exact problem, but problems feeding on themselves, and the things get worse and worse and worse. People get more and more unhappy, our products get worse and worse, and we really don't know how to get out of it. I want to contrast this with what I think of as a virtuous cycle. And you probably have farms like this around in this area. I happen to love food. I love really fresh food that comes from farms like this, where maybe they raise cows, pigs, chickens, vegetables, grain, all together in the same place, or at least on neighboring farms. And what we find is that when you raise chickens and cows, then you can use those to fertilize the crops, and then you can use the crops to feed the animals. And you get this, again, this kind of virtuous cycle where sunlight is coming in, and then really, really good food is coming out. And to me, that's a virtuous cycle. And when I think about companies, I've begun to think about them in some sense as farms and products as the crops, as the things that we raise off. So I'm sort of an organic farmer for software. But the point I want to make is that when we start thinking about how to make better software, how to get better at what we do, we often think that it's a solo practice. It's us getting better at our own craft and doing better and better on our own. But really, there's a huge opportunity out there in getting better together, in learning how to work better together. And what I find is when I walk into companies and I see the problems, it's not the skills of the individuals that are the problem, it's the way that we work together. And so what I want to talk to you about today is sort of like how we work together and the opportunities that I see in that. So again, my name's Bob Gower. I have had many jobs over the years. I have never been a developer, but I have been a product manager, I've been a UX designer, I've been a design director, I actually started in the newspaper world. I'm currently an Agile coach with a company named Rally Software. We're based in Boulder, Colorado, but we are actually a global company. We have an office in Amsterdam, an office in London. I myself am based in New York City. Through my work as an Agile coach, I spend a lot of time, I travel around, and I work with a lot of different companies. And through my work as an Agile coach, I've come to value this cycle more than any other. Do you understand this cycle? Maybe let me walk you through it a little bit. So on the left, we have happy people, right? Happy employees, for lack of a better word. You guys, happy you guys. And in the middle, the sun. This represents really great products, really innovative products, really, really well-made, well-crafted, high-quality products that are going to customers, and the customers love these products, and they can afford these products. I think that's an important distinction to make. And they're paying money back to those happy developers, and everybody's happy. And again, we have this virtuous cycle. Everything gets better and better and better over time. So everything I talk about today is going to be in the context of this, trying to create this virtuous cycle. And don't worry, I'm going to stay a little high level, then I'm going to get really specific, and then I'm going to give you guys a chance to ask me some questions about how things work in your world, okay? So this is important. It's really important that we create virtuous cycles. It's more important now than ever. What these three companies all have in common is that they are becoming irrelevant, if not already irrelevant. 5 years ago, just 5 years ago, they controlled almost 70% of the cell phone device market, right, of the mobile device market. And now, each of these companies has suffered a huge market loss. And who's leading us now? Who's leading the mobile device market now? Two companies that weren't even players 5 years ago. And we've seen this over and over again, disruptions in our industry. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Instagram, which took 18 months to sell to Facebook for I don't know how many billion, like 1 point something, or maybe even more than 1 billion. I should have that number, but I don't. But they sold for a lot of money in just 18 months. These companies, our markets are getting more and more disruptive, more and more chaotic. And this trend is only going to continue. Our technologies are catching up. Our technologies are actually driving this. What's not driving it is the way we work together. We still work together as if we're building cars in the 1970s, and we're not building cars in the 1970s anymore. We are building mobile technologies, we're building SaaS technologies, cloud technologies, and we need to catch up. We need to start thinking in new ways about how we work together. This is my passion, and this is what I spend my time on. So again, I told you I was going to stay high level. I'm going to go high level for just a few more minutes before we get down into the specifics. I want to talk about how we think like a system. We need to begin thinking as if something is an actual system, as if our organizations are systems, as if our technology, of which our technology is a part. When we think about a system, it's very, very, very tempting to think about it like this. Going back to my poverty idea, right? That we sort of think that on the end we have bad situation in our cities, and we can sort of back up one step at a time and look for the root cause, look for the source. But the reality is it doesn't work like this. We tend to do the same things over and over and over again in what we call a recursive cycle, right? It goes back in on itself. And it's worse than this. In fact, what happens is that each of these things feeds on itself. So if we're trying to solve poverty, and then we're looking at education, we're looking at the way families are raised, we're looking at drug abuse, if we're trying to look at all of these things in our cities, or if we're just trying to make our customer happy or our employees happy, knowing where to work is incredibly challenging. And it gets even worse than this because really, this is the kind of system I think that we're inside of. It's really beautiful, right? But it's also chaotic, it's also crazy, and I think our job is to learn how to sort of exist inside of this chaotic world. And that's going to be a core career skill that each one of us is going to need to develop on our own, and then our companies need to develop structures that allow us to do this. One of the things, have you guys heard, I want to just see a show of hands, have you heard of something called the butterfly effect? Okay, so the butterfly effect is the idea that a butterfly's wings flapping in one hemisphere on one side of the earth can cause a storm on the other side. And this is a causative link. The flapping of the wings can actually cause something to happen on the other side of the world, something big. This happens in our own businesses, right? Very, very small changes can lead to big results. This is power. This is also a problem. Because if sometimes we make a very small change, we think it's insignificant, and the end result is very, very bad. It's very bad for our customer, very bad for our markets. Think of all the decisions that RIM made that were probably very, very small, but have resulted in that company becoming less and less relevant and rapidly losing market share. But likewise, we can look at very small changes, and this is what I want to talk about now, is the small changes that we can make and how we work together that can actually have huge impact on our customers, on the quality of our lives, on the quality of our products, and I think, ultimately, on our culture and on our world and making our world a better place. So when I think of a healthy system, I think of a healthy system having in software. Now I'm going to talk about software now, okay? So when I think of a healthy system, I think of it having four things. First, we want to make sure that we're building the right thing, that we're building features that our customers actually want. There's a huge waste in our industry, and that huge waste is that most of the stuff, I would say over 50% of the features that we develop, nobody really uses. And we have to figure out how to reduce this number. We have to figure out how to focus on what it is people actually want. And I'm going to describe how to do that in just a few minutes. The other thing we want to do is we want to build the thing right. Once we've decided what to build, we want to build it something that's quality. We want to build it on budget. We want to build it on time. We want to make sure that our development cycles work really, really, really well together. The other thing is we want to organize people like they are people, not resources. Has anybody here been called a resource? Yeah. I don't like being called a resource, right? I'm a human being. That said, right, we do need to work together, and we do need to look at skill sets and the way people work. So we need to begin organizing our businesses around the way our brains really work and the way our societies really work. And we're going to talk a little bit about the science behind that and also sort of the opportunity there and specific things we can do. And then the fourth thing is that we need to plan for change. Our markets are going to change. Our understanding of those markets are going to change. Our technology is going to change. We need to change, and we need to expect change. It can't be that we create this big requirements document and we imagine that we can see the future even 3 months in advance. We need to be able to build our systems and build our organizations so we can change, and so we can change with the times and our understanding of the times. So let's take these one at a time. Building the right thing. This means that we need to focus on value. Rather than focusing on technology, rather than focusing on innovation, rather than focusing on all of the things that we normally, you know, the noisy stuff, we need to be focused on value, and this means we need to focus on our customer, that we need to understand our customer. Now, I know many of you probably build, you probably get a requirements document from your customer, and they say, build this for our customer, right? That's probably what a lot of you do. But you need to be thinking about your customer's customer. Who are you building this for? Who is the end user of this? And I guarantee you, if you begin asking questions about who that customer is and what it is and who they want the application for, they're going to be very happy with you. Your customer is going to be really happy with you and want to keep coming back. I know I'm a product guy. This is what I've always done. And when my developers ask me about the customer, about the end user, I get very, very, very happy. So I'm an agile coach, so I'm going to talk about agile for just a minute here. And I like to work in an iterative life cycle. And to me, if I'm talking about building the right thing and staying focused on value, it means that I need to develop a life cycle for my product where I can deliver value on a regular basis. And so I work in these kind of, again, these little cycles. There are little cycles here where I plan, design, and build and test and deploy even very, very frequently, sometimes every 2 weeks. Sometimes I even work with companies that are deploying even more than every 2 weeks. I think Facebook, right, they can deploy 4 times a day now. Of course, they're a unique company in a SaaS environment. But we need to begin thinking like this. I've also worked on data warehousing projects. So, you know, I've worked on a wide spectrum, everything from SaaS to these very, very long data warehousing projects. We actually even work with John Deere right now, who builds the software systems for diesel engines. So I work in very long cycles, but we begin to apply this mental model to it. What this means is that I'm delivering more and more value over time, like a little bit of value, a little bit of value, a little bit of value. This is really good for the bottom line. It's really great for, you know, because look at all the money that I get. I start getting money right away. And every couple of weeks, I love how you can see the finger thinking, right? You can almost see what's going on inside the user's mind as he's working on this. So how many people are using paper prototyping right now, doing this kind of methodology, right? There are, what, three people? Okay, a few more in the room. Okay, great. So I would say, looking out at the room, we have about, you know, 5%, something like that. So you get the idea. So if you're not doing something like this, I highly recommend it. We have to come up with ways for our thinking and our understanding to change. We need to be able to develop our thinking in very, very, very fast ways. And we can't be afraid of it. I'm a writer, actually. I'm working on my first book right now that hopefully will be coming out in maybe September of or October of this year. And I can tell you how hard it is for me to show my writing to somebody. But every time I do, it gets better. And so we have to be willing to do this. We have to be willing to show things. Thanks. Great. So that was building the right thing. So let's talk about building the thing right. So if we're going to build the thing right, we got to focus. You can't have your attention all over the place. The human mind is really, really, really terrible at looking at more than one thing at once, right? We're very, very bad at multitasking. As a matter of fact, all of the psychological research that's come out in about the last 10 years shows that multitasking is a myth. And that there's a huge cost to changing context, to moving from one thing to another. So this means we need to limit WIP. You guys know what WIP is? Work in progress, right? So this comes from an idea from Kanban, which is the Toyota production system. Toyota, a lot of my thinking really comes out of what Toyota did for cars back in the 70s and 80s, is what I'm trying to do for software today. But we need to limit WIP. And what this means is that we only want to be working on a couple of things at a time. So we have to be focused, and we have to be really and get absolutely nowhere. What we really want to do is we want to align things. And when things become aligned, there's almost this effortless beauty that can happen inside of our organizations. The way we generally align is we tell people what to do. Command and control. You do this. And then my superior tells me what to do. Then I tell my subordinate what to do. Then they tell their subordinate what to do. And pretty soon we have a bunch of people who are really unhappy to be at work, really unmotivated to be at work, and not very creative. And what we do, what you do, is very, very, very creative work. It requires a lot of brain power. And I want people to be motivated and interested and excited to be at work, not doing stuff just because my stupid boss told me to do something. What we're looking for is collaborative teams. We're looking for teams of people that work together and are happy to come to work each day. These are the people who can change the world. These are the people who can create truly, deeply innovative products. But what happens is in our companies is we have our wonderful developer and we chop her up, right? 50% of her time is over here, 25% of her time is over there, 25% of her time is on that project. So now all she's tracking all of these projects, and not only that, but each of these projects is actually asking for more of the time than she's allocated to. This is our allocated resource. Anybody ever felt like this? Anybody feel like this right now? Yeah. A much better way to work is to take those projects and divide them into a backlog and then let her choose what she pulls off of this backlog. Again, we know what's most important, we know what's the highest value, and she can pull this off one at a time, and it's even better if we have a small team doing this. So that's one way that we can move forward. It's one way that we can organize our teams and we can begin to organize people as if they are actually people. Give them autonomy over what to do and how to do it, and when to do it, right? Some companies, my company is one of them, is experimenting. We're pretty radical. We allow people to have we really talk about people having a work and a life and having those things work together. When I was younger and my back was stronger, I came out of college and I was a carpenter. This was my job for a couple of years. I had a hammer and a belt, and I still think of it as one of the most fun jobs and one of the best jobs I've ever had in my life. And the reason for that is because I had a lot of pride in my work. We did really high quality work. And every day after I would leave the job, after the job was over, and I worked very hard. We worked like 10, 12 hour days sometimes, especially in summertime when there was a lot of sunlight. And I would find myself walking around, having my last cigarette of the day. I would walk around, and I would look at all that we had done that day. And I had a huge amount of pride in that. And it turns out that there's a sound psychological basis for why I felt so good. And that is that, if you look at the research, the thing that makes people happy at work, it's not money. Money helps. You got to make enough, right? We all got to make enough. But it's not like I'm happier at the job that pays me 20% more than the other job. That's not the thing that makes me happy. It's not pizza parties. It's not trips. It's not conferences. It's not free coffee. It's none of these things. What it is it's the ability to make incremental progress on something that you personally find meaningful. That you can look back at the end of the day, the end of the week, every 2 weeks, and say, look what I did. And it's even better if you can watch somebody use it. I've seen people actually, in certain industries, almost move to tears when they watch somebody use their software and get value out of their software. It's an incredibly powerful thing. Has anybody ever really watched somebody use your software and just felt a strong sense of pride? You guys felt that? I hope to see a lot of hands, and believe me, it's possible. And these are the kinds of companies that we are trying to build. This is the kinds of company that I hope you get to work in, and I hope you can create for yourself. This also means that we need to plan for change, right? We need to plan as if our markets are going to change. And I'm not going to say much about this because I want to get to your questions, but I do want to say a couple of things. When I think of planning and when I think of planning a product, it exists on several levels. First, we have the vision. What is it that we really want to create? What's the difference that we want to make in the world? We also think about our roadmap. Okay, well, how are we going to get there? Then we might think about our release schedule. Well, we'll do this release, then this release, then this release. And then we might have our iteration, you know, like every 2 weeks or so we're doing these kinds of things. And then every day we want people to plan. They want to sit, they come into the office, they sit down, what am I going to do today? Now, ideally, when I come and sit down in my office and I think, what am I going to do today, that's intimately tied to the vision. It's completely in line. There's no waste in this process, right? But often what happens is what people are doing on a day-to-day basis sometimes has nothing to do with the vision of the product. Sometimes we lose things. There's a loss at each step along the way. There's another problem with this, and that problem is that what's happening on the daily basis, that the information all flows only in one direction, flows only from the top to the bottom. Again, that command and control. You do this, you do this, you do this. But the vision needs to be informed by what we're learning on a daily basis. The iteration needs to be informed by that. The release needs to be informed by the iteration. The roadmap needs to be informed by the release. Because we learn and we change and it becomes in some ways more exciting and more interesting over time. So we need to build management systems that allow for this. Thank you. Dwight Eisenhower liked to say, plans are nothing, but planning is everything. That means we need to plan, and we need to plan all the time. I think planning should be happening almost on a daily basis in most companies. But we cannot get attached to our plan. We cannot get attached to this big, you know, business requirements document and think that it's the Bible and that we can't change it. We need to be changing. We need to come up with flexible systems that we can change. We need to think of our company somewhat like the space shuttle. The space shuttle is on target only about 3% of the time. The rest of the time, it's slightly off and slightly off and slightly off. It's doing constant and continual course correction. It's very much like riding a bicycle, right? We're dynamically steering. We're constantly doing these little course corrections. And we need to begin to think about our businesses as if they are bicycles or space shuttles. And believe me, this seems really far apart, doesn't it? Bicycle, space shuttle, but it's the same idea. So right now, hopefully, if I've done my job, you're thinking, well, that's never going to happen in my business because, you know, things are crazy. But let's talk a little bit about just how to get there, how to change your system. Over time, we want to change. Over time, we want our ability to get together. I don't know if you can read that, but we have time and we have ability. Over time, we want to get better and better. Often we tried something new. It can be something personal, like a weight loss program, exercise, diet change, whatever that may be, and we just drop out and we give off. We give up. Sometimes we're successful and we figure out a new way to do something, and we think we've got it. Now I understand. Now I know. But that's really an amateur's mindset. And what I want to encourage you to have today is I want you to have, encourage you to have the mindset of an expert. And the mindset of an expert is not happy. Well, not satisfied. We may be happy, but we're never satisfied. We always think there's a better way. I need to keep pushing. There's always a better way. And this is what's going to improve our companies. This is what's going to improve our lives. This is what's going to improve the lives of our customers and our products. What this means is that we need to look back on a regular basis. We need to retrospect, and on a very regular basis, I recommend every couple of weeks that your entire team sits down with each other and says, how did we do? How can we do better? How did we do, and how can we do better? And be religious about this this meeting. This meeting is probably the most important meeting. If you're going to do anything that I recommend today, I would recommend starting here. That every 2 weeks you put a meeting on the calendar, and I recommend that you buy refreshments for that meeting. You make it fun, you make it enjoyable, and you look back. How did we do? How can we do better? And no finger pointing. Well, you did okay. You did terribly. But I did great. No, you know, like, how did we do? And build that team spirit. Maybe go out for a meal together. So I just want to finish with a quick story that you may be thinking that we can make a change, but only if we get rid of those bad people in my company. In the 1970s, there was a car plant in California near San Francisco that was the worst in the industry. It was the worst plant that General Motors, the GM, had. And the stories that come out of it are terrible. There was rampant alcohol use in the plant. There was prostitution in the plant. There was drug use in the plant. And you can bet they made really terrible stuff. Like, really bad stuff came out of this plant. And people were just unhappy with their jobs. What happened is they were going to close the plant, but instead they decided to try to adopt the Toyota production system. They actually entered into a joint agreement with Toyota. And it went from the worst plant to the most successful plant. And people were happy there. The plant actually closed last year, or 2 years ago, with GM's troubles. But when it closed, I listened to interviews of the people they talked to. And the people were literally in tears, not because they lost their jobs, but because they lost something that was meaningful. They said that this place changed their lives. Not only that, but they produced some of the best cars that have ever come out of an American plant. So the people's lives improved. They became happier and they became better. But the crux of this story is that they didn't change the people. These were the same people. In fact, the leaders, the union leadership that presided over the bad place, were also the same people that presided over the good place. What they changed was how they worked together. And I think this is possible for all of us, and this is my mission in life. I just want to say, if you adopt some of these ideas, I think you're going to be happier yourself. You're going to make better products. Your customers are going to be happier. You're ultimately going to make more money. And really what I think we're up to here is we are on the cutting edge of innovation right now, mobile especially. And we're going to be able to make the world a little bit better place. And to me, that's what it's all about. So I thank you very much. Again, my name is Bob Gower. My contact info is here. That's my company, Rally Software. BobCanHelp.com is my blog. If you go there and subscribe, you can maybe see when, hopefully, if I finish this book, that it'll come out. And please contact me in the hallway. Write down my email. Feel free to send me an email. And thank you very much.
Please, if you have any questions, please come to the microphones and ask. Or just show your hand and you will get a microphone. Hey, okay. No questions?
I thought that was a question.
Oh. Okay.
thank you for your presentation. Basically, I have a question about motivation. And do you have some secret about how to motivate people and how to make people proud right now what they do and not? Because you're saying that people are really like when see that somebody uses their software. But how to make them happy right now and proud what they do right now? Mm-hmm. And maybe some secret from your experience.
I'll do my best with that. And so the question is really about motivation. What do we do to motivate people? How do we have them have some pride in what they do? And I would say that I want to just sort of tweak the question a little bit. And I would say it's not so much how do we make people or how do we push people to do something. People naturally want to be motivated. People naturally want to do good work. Making bad stuff feels bad. Making good stuff feels good. What we need to do, I think, as managers and executives, is we need to begin to get out of people's way a little bit. There's a wonderful book by a man named Daniel Pink, and the book is called Drive. I highly recommend it. He also gives a wonderful talk on that you can look up online. Anyways, Dan Pink, and the book is Drive. What he says is that what works, and he's looking at the science behind this, what works is three things. The first is that we need to give people autonomy. Like, the people, it's weird, right? But we want to direct our own lives. We don't want someone telling us what to do. We want to have some sense of self-direction. Now, there's different kinds of autonomy. There's autonomy over time, like when we do something. There's autonomy over task, what we do. And there's autonomy over method, like how we do something. And generally speaking, it's easiest to give people autonomy over the how. It's hardest to give people autonomy over the time because we're trying to coordinate large teams. But to the extent that we can give people a sense that they can drive their own lives, then that's great. The other two things are giving people a sense of mastery, allowing people to get better and better and better at their craft, allowing them to come to conferences like this, getting some training. Maybe if someone's not an expert in a technology, but still allowing them to work in that technology so they can feel like they're getting better, complex problems, that excites people, that engages people. And then the last thing is a sense of purpose. And that's giving people an understanding of who their customer is, why we're building what we're building, setting vision. And I think really, to me, that's the job of the leadership in an organization, is to give vision. Like primarily, when I work on projects and I lead projects, I always think of my first job is to understand the vision and communicate that vision and actually over-communicate that vision over and over and over again. So, thank you. Sure. So I work in all different kinds of technology. So in many ways, I don't worry so much about the technology that people are working on, because I come into the room and I'm curious about whether people like each other or not. That's really what I care about. And if people don't like each other, how I can help them like each other more. But I do know you guys, working in mobile, that you have a couple of things. And one is that I know you work on very short projects. Right, most of your projects are probably under a year, and the teams probably change an awful lot. And I think that's one of the challenges that you face. And I'd say is there a way that we can keep our teams persistent over many projects rather than sort of reformulating our teams many times? The other thing I would say is, and just knowing what part of the world that I'm in, is I've seen teams which are distributed, right, where you have engineering in one country, in one time zone, right, and QA in another, and business in another. And I think that's a huge challenge, and it's not just in the mobile industry, but it's sort of across industries right now. And, we can use technology to help, but, right now, if you had people in New York City right now that you were working closely with, right, it's like 4 a.m. or 5 a.m. for them right now. So the time zone shift is really challenging. So, one recommendation I would have in that space is just, can we get people together to have one meal together or two meals together? Can we get everybody together in one hemisphere all at once to at least see each other and be together face to face and remember that we're actually working together and we're working as people? And then, I think the other thing that Yev, you and I talked about the other day around development is that the way many people here probably work is that you're being told what to build, right? Here's the requirement, just build it. And I would say, again, and I kind of want to emphasize this, that what you need to do is you need to actually engage with your customer about who it is they're building things for and really understand their customer. They're going to be much happier. They're probably not going to think to ask you that often because they're going to say, here, build it, right? That command and control thing.